Hi, my name is Paolo Gaudenzi. I'm from Rome, Italy, and I'm at the University of Rome La Sapienza, where I'm serving as a full professor of aerospace structures, but I'm also the director of the Master in Satellites, or Master in Satellite Systems and Services. Today, I would like to discuss with you an issue that is very important for the development of space systems. That is to say, concurrent design. We will be talking about this new procedure for designing complicated systems like space systems, and see what is the work that we have done at La Sapienza in this frame of procedures. Actually, space systems are rather complicated. Since you have to perform a real effort in order to place spacecraft in orbits or to allow them to do a trajectory in space, and in order to deploy a mission, you need to have a system that basically is composed by three segments: the launch segment, that is the one that enabled the satellite to reach the final trajectory when it's performing its mission and its functional activity; the space segment itself, that is to say the spacecraft composed by the payload and the bus, and the bus is composed by several different subsystems; and of course there is the need of a ground segment that is collecting all the data and the information coming from the satellite and is giving to the satellites the command that is that are needed for performing the mission. All those segments actually are describing the architecture of a system that is a rather complicated one in terms of parts, in terms of subsystems, in terms of assembly, and it's not only a problem of an hardware, but it's also all the software that is allowing the hardware to work properly. So such a combination of parts that eventually to perform an important mission, that is the scope of the mission, maybe a telecom service or an Earth observation to be performed, required a lot of competencies, a lot of engineering disciplines to be put together in order to face the challenges of the mission, to face the challenging aspects of deploying a space system. So, even at the level of design, without thinking about the production, the manufacturing, the industrialization, and the operation of all such a system, so starting from design, we can easily understand that satellite system design is actually a highly multidisciplinary effort. Many experts coming from different areas of competencies should work together for designing a spacecraft system that is able to reach the required performances. And this should be done while respecting cost and schedule and minimizing the risk for the mission. So we see that there is a combination of different competencies and areas of, let's say, engineering sciences to be put together during the design phase. And also, this is a matter of a team effort of people coming from different competencies that need to have a common approach and a common way of interacting and sharing both knowledge and data in order to reach a design of a system that is a proper design for the needs and the requirement that the mission actually asks to the design phase. So at the University of Rome La Sapienza, we have been working on this multidisciplinary topic for quite a while in the last 10 to 15 years, and we have developed some procedure that are aligned with all these difficulties and follow basically the conceptual and preliminary phases of the project. We have examined the role of cost engineering and risk management in that area, and this will all deal with this new concept of system engineering design, that is the concurrent engineering procedure. But before entering concurrent engineering, let's spend a word on how costs are involved in the design process. So costs are also a part of the engineering design, not only an issue to be considered during the development during of the project or during the management of the project. Cost is actually something that should be related to the design itself. We can evaluate with the help of this diagram what is the evolution of the cost of a space project or a space system during all the phases of its life. We start in the axis, in the horizontal axis, we have time and we have different phases of development. First, we have the concept phase of the mission. Then we have the design and development. Well, the design really comes to major decision up to the final decision, usually conceptualized and described in a deadline that is called the critical design review, the CDR of a space project, after which the phase of industrialization, manufacturing, production takes place, and eventually the satellite system is placed in orbit, the spacecraft is launched, and operations are coming. In the x-axis, we have the development time for our space project, and on the vertical axis, we have the cost of such a project. The important concept here is to understand that for an industrial product like this space system, in the preliminary phases of the activity, we determined approximately 90-95% of the total amount of life cycle cost. So we make important decisions that determine the cost at the very end of the activity. At the same time, in such phases that are preliminary, the design phases namely, we are not spending too much money, because such phases only require a small percentage of the total cost. So if you see the diagram, we have the incurrent cost as a percentage of the total cost, that is to say the cost of the activity while we are doing them, and of course this is added from activity to activity. So we start in with the red diagram by spending not so much money in the concept and in the design phase. Then during of course industrialization, production, and then during launch and all the time needed for operations, we spend the most of our money. At the same time, we have committed cost as a percentage of the total cost, that is to say that the cost is determined by our decision, that is quite high at the very first stages of our activity, reaching something that could be up to 90 or 95% of the total cost, while we just spent 5% maybe of the total amount. So preliminary phases of the activity are really important, because if we are not taking cost under control, at the end of our activity, we would have a cost that might go beyond our expectation, both in terms of the price that is recognized by the client to the developer, to the industry that was providing the space system, or if not a price, that will be the final cost that maybe a government was paying for the deployment of a space system. So preliminary phases are really important for determination of the total cost of the system, and it is really important not to make mistakes in these preliminary phases. And this is a very good motivation to introduce in the design of a space system an advanced technique for design that is related to the complexity of the multidisciplinary feature of such kind of engineering systems. What do we mean by concurrent engineering? Let's have an historical background. We understand that there are many disciplines that are involved in the development of a spacecraft, because basically the payload and all the main subsystem of the spacecraft need a special or some special areas of competencies. For instance, just naming the subsystem of the bus of a spacecraft, you will have a competence in structural mechanics for the primary structural subsystem of the bus. You will need some competence in electrical engineering in the area of the power subsystem of the spacecraft. You would need a competence in space telecoms while dealing with the telemetry tracking and command subsystem of the spacecraft. And this is true also for propulsion, for the propulsion subsystems, or for thermal analysis while dealing with the thermal subsystem. And you need also a competence in attitude analysis and control for the alignment of the spacecraft in the AOCS system. So a bunch of different areas of competencies that are covering different areas or different parts of the subsystem of the spacecraft. We might consider a strategy to do the design of the overall system that is called sequential design, meaning that the overall project is given to a certain area of competences, a certain area of competence, and then this area of competence transmits the conclusion to another area. Saying, for instance, that we start with the design of the payload, and then from the design of the payload we pass the action to the structural subsystem, and then from the structural subsystem we go to thermal analysis, and then from the thermal area of competence we go to propulsion, and so on. So a sequential process. By doing that, at each step just one area of competence is working. All the information from previous steps are transmitted to that area of competence that makes its own decision and allow the project to progress. By doing that, there is a loss of efficiency in the system, because while one area is working, the other areas are not working, or if they are working, they are not working on the updated information, since they have the updated information only when all the cycle of the steps passing through the different areas of competence is completed. A much better way of organizing things is a centralized design procedure. If you have a central system design area of competence, and all the area of specialization are connected with this central area in order to make the system more efficient. But this is not efficient enough, because the centralized design and the center of the area of competence in which all decisions are concentrated might be a bottleneck, might be an area in which there are too many information concentrated in these small areas, and in this small area, and all the process of exchanging and sharing information is not performed in an efficient way. Basically, in a concurrent design procedure, we have the development in parallel for the system and all the system of the spacecraft, and there is a simultaneous sharing of the information and the decisions on the process of design, so that everybody can perform simultaneously its own action, and at the same time it's sharing the decision of the other areas of competence and could discuss the consequences of the decisions of the other people in the in its own area. So this process is much more efficient in terms of development times, and also in order to avoid misevaluation or mistakes or bad choices for during the design, because everything has to be shared among all the actors of the design process. This procedure in system design has been since long time developed at NASA and also at ESA. And ESA has even a definition for what is considered a concurrent design approach. For ESA, concurrent engineering is a systematic approach to integrate product development, and this approach emphasizes the response to customer expectations, since only working by sharing the information also on the requirements by the client, also working with this kind of approach, the requirements by the clients would be really met. So, according to ESA, a concurrent engineering procedure embodies team values of cooperation, trust, and sharing in such a manner that decision making is by consensus, involving all perspectives, meaning all the area of competence, all the areas of competence are considered in parallel from the beginning of the product life cycle. And we, of course, we totally share this idea of the European Space Agency and this definition of concurrent engineering that is important in general for any complicated engineering system, but it's very important for space systems, as we mentioned already. So basically, the idea is to provide both system and subsystem design by implementing this way of parallel design process in all the areas of competencies that needs, of course, a way of cooperation and sharing data, information, and sharing the decisions that each area of competencies is making during the design process.